But the number one reason that I have found, and I have talked to a survivor from Rwanda, and I said, why did the Hutus kill the Tutsis? He said, well, the economy was very bad. And they had to blame it on somebody. We were the minority, they were the majority. So they had to blame it on somebody, and we were the most convenient scapegoat. I think, and I'm not sure, I haven't studied too many genocides. I only studied the Holocaust and talked to a survivor of Rwanda. But I think the underlying problem is always the economy. When people are well fed and they have no worries about raising their children, you cannot sell them a bill of goods. But when everybody is desperate, then they will listen to just about anything. And the interesting thing is, in my opinion, that the bullies, meaning the leaders who use prejudice and scapegoating, they are never going to pick on the majority. They always pick on the minority because nobody was going to stand up for the Jews. Nobody was going to stand up for the handicapped, for the gypsies, but the Jews were the main target, except that the others did not fit Hitler's ideal for an Aryan race, and he wanted to create a perfect Aryan race. So we have a poster at the museum that talks about racial purity. The Nazis were obsessed with racial purity, and in order to somehow live up to that crazy idea of racial purity, they were going to eliminate, kill all those people who might in some way threaten that purity. The funny thing was that when I met with Dr. Munch in 1993, it's going to be 20 years this July, that I asked him what did he think about the Nazi philosophy. And he said to me, it was sick. I said, what do you mean? He said, it's scientifically incorrect. Because they were going to raise tall, healthy, good-looking, pure bred Aryans. And he said, scientifically speaking, the purer a breed is, the weaker it becomes. Of course, we know that from the end, that was the first time that I kind of looked at him. A Nazi is telling me that the Nazi philosophy scientifically incorrect. Yeah. So they had that. So we have reason number one is always the economy. Two is prejudice. In the situation of the Holocaust, there was the Treaty of Versailles, correct? As a history teacher, from many people I have heard that it was the most difficult thing for people to live with, Germans. Because Germans also considered themselves super, was the statement that Germans said, Übermensch. They were, nothing could touch them. They were superhuman beings. And that they weren't super or weren't perfect, they could not accept it. So therefore, they wanted everybody else to be perfect. But reason number three, reason number four was eugenics. And you talk about eugenics. It really started in Indiana. When the government of Indiana in 1905 passed a law that young people could not get married unless the government did a thorough study of their genetic background. And to, because then they wouldn't have healthy children. What an interesting turn. 100 or more years later, so many kids are born out of wedlock. So getting a permit to get married doesn't seem quite that important. Yes. And by 1907, the state sterilized those people who were genetically, they called them fit to breed. They were not fit to have children. And these were not Jews, nor were they black people, nor were they handicapped people. They were young people in orphanages. So socially, they were misfitted, so to speak. And then 39 other states adopted the eugenics law. And a total of almost 164,000 Americans were sterilized under the eugenics law. Well, articles have been written about it, and Hitler read one of those articles, and he liked the idea that he had control over reproduction. And also a very famous German scientific institution in Germany, the Kaiser Wilhelm Institute for Genetic Studies, started studying identical twins. Why identical twins? If you want to study genetics, twins are identical, almost the same. They wanted to understand. These were all volunteers, children or grown-ups, and they always had their clothes on. They would observe them and maybe even measure to see the dimensions of the head, if they were the same, nose, something, but not anything very intrusive. And by 1937, the institute director, Dr. Vashur, Varon, Otmar von Vashur, got a new an assistant by the name of Dr. Josef Mengele. So Josef Mengele had 2 degrees, one in anthropology, a PhD in anthropology, and a medical degree. And he was very enthusiastic about the study of twins. Well, the war broke out, and he was drafted into the German army in end of 1939 or 1940, and was sent to the Russian front. He was injured in 1942 and was sent to Berlin to recover. And in 1943, he recovered and was declared unfit for battle. So he remained in Germany and went to see his professor, very interested in seeing how the study of twins was progressing. Then Professor Bashur said to him, "We don't have any volunteers." And this is when Bashur and Mengele decided that there had to be a lot of twins arriving in Auschwitz and the various camps. And so Mengele was sent by the Kaiser. Mengele was representing the Kaiser Wilhelm Institute for Genetic Studies, the most prestigious German scientific institution then and today. And you can find it if you Google Nazi medical experiments, it will get you through it from the beginning to the end. And many German pharmaceutical companies, headed by Bayer, they were very interested in studying diseases, germs, and drugs. So this is when it became dangerous. But this was when Hitler rose to power. This is also the reason that I survived, because I had a chance to survive. Because as Hitler was under Hitler's genetic law, or eugenics law that he passed in 1933, it stated that Jews, gypsies, physically and mentally handicapped, Jehovah's Witnesses, homosexuals, and anybody who opposed him was genetically inferior and had no right to live. So under the eugenics law, most people, when they talk about the 6 million Jews, nobody really says what ID did Hitler use. But he used eugenics. They were genetically inferior, these people, and therefore they should be eliminated. And actually, Hitler should have been at the front of the line because he wasn't blue-eyed blonde, nor was he fitting any of the ideals that he was describing. But I guess he excluded himself from these laws. And that is, they were trying to replenish the population that they were eliminating, over 11 million people. He wanted that every German mother who was expecting would have at least twins or triplets or four or more children. So in Auschwitz, they collected fraternal twins also. And there were about 1,500 sets of twins collected in Auschwitz. The estimated number of survivors is less than 200 individuals. So it wasn't that easy to survive, but you had a chance, much better chance than otherwise. And reason number five was appeasement. Everybody appeased Hitler. Even people in Germany and Jews said, oh, maybe he's not so bad. He doesn't really mean all the things he wrote in his book. But Hitler was as bad as he said he was. And in my opinion, we cannot ever appease any terrorist, because Hitler was a Nazi terrorist. In the world, there are other kind of terrorists, and appeasing terrorists, it doesn't work. So I think I finished my dinner. I was lecturing at the local penitentiary. We have a national
U.S. penitentiary
in Terre Haute. This is where Timothy McVeigh was executed, by the way. Yeah. And they have a program, advanced program, to help inmates. And they were all screened, 100 of them. And the warden said to me, by the way, I didn't like going to the prison. I will tell you why. They wanted to take my purse away and put it somewhere. I said, no, I take my key. My car is outside. I'll go put it in the car and come back. I don't want somebody. I don't trust the world that much to put my purse in some cubicle there. Anyway, and I lectured to them, and then I opened it up for questions. And about 10, they were sitting right in the front. They had to be all Muslim because they had Muslim skull caps. That is the only reason. And they, in unison, said, we don't believe a single word you said. We don't think any of it happened. I said, well, that's interesting. I really wish that it was true. But just because I wish that it didn't happen doesn't make it so. I know that I had a mother and a father. I have pictures with them. I have pictures with my sisters. I also have pictures with cousins. And they all just disappeared from the face of this earth. You tell me, where are they? What happened to them, since you say it didn't happen? And the warden apologized. I said, I didn't expect such a question, but in my opinion, if they ask a question like that as a group, there is a political agenda.
Yeah.
But that was the reason when I went to Auschwitz, when I went to meet Dr. Munch and ask him about the gas chambers, my idea was to get that document. And if you go on our website, you can Google CandleHolocaustMuseum.org, and then click on Education Center, and the next paragraph will come up with letters to the world. This is Dr. Munch's documenting the gas chamber, And my forgiveness letter, we have a letter from Alex that you wrote about what?
I think that's when I was 37, I wrote just think about just being a child of Holocaust survivor.
Yeah.
I gave a speech in Denver, and I think I used that to write an essay.
You were 37? That was last year, right?
That was 2 years in the future.
That is the idea of being in the future. You know that I live in the year 2025 already. I borrow time from the future. Because there are 24 hours a day is not enough for me, so I somehow borrow from the future. So according to that, I am already living in the year 2025. Just a thought, silly thought that I do. And really, what can you do if people don't believe you? The proof and all the documentation. And I didn't want to really argue with prisoners because maybe I don't quite respect their opinion that much. But I wanted to ask them, why on earth are you saying that? But I thought, what are they going to tell me? That I have proof that the camp exists, that I had parents, that millions of people just disappeared from the face of this earth. And of course, even the United States Army, General Eisenhower, said to people, take pictures. So many American GIs have lots of pictures of what happened and what they saw, because the world will not believe unless we can document it. And they still want to deny it. So I guess it's convenient that Ahmadinejad, you know, Alex, we should kill?
Yeah.
We should send our documentation of the gas chamber to Ahmadinejad.
Sure.
Why not?
Well, you should tell about the video you did on YouTube and send it to...
Yeah. Well, this is the way that the first summer trip came about to Auschwitz. Actually, Ahmadinejad is involved in it. I go to the museum and there is a message. Somebody called me by the name of Ted Albert. I knew the name very well. He was bureau chief of NBC in 1985 when we went back to Auschwitz for the 40th anniversary to the liberation of the camp. And I said to the receptionist, he called, and this is, yeah, I think he lives in Terre Haute. Wow. So I called him, I got an answering machine, and I said, Ted Albert, bureau chief for NBC in Germany, and he came from Germany to Auschwitz. Well, if I figure out correctly, I know that one of the representative of NBC working with the national NBC was Vicky Wagner. Somehow, do you have anything to do with Vicky Wagner and you moved to Terre Haute? And he called me back, you're right. Well, he said to me, Eva, you ought, it was December, let's see, 2006, or November 2006, and the conference was in December 2006 in Tehran, a deniers conference hosted by Ahmadinejad, Mahmoud Ahmadinejad. And he said, you should go there and confront him. I said, Ted, that's very nice of you, but I am not volunteering to be a victim. If I go to Tehran, can you assure me that I'm going to get out of there alive, or will they put me in jail? And I don't volunteer for these projects to spend my life in jail. So I said, well, but you should do something. I said, okay, thanks a lot. So I thought, well, I thought about it, and I said, maybe I need to invite Ahmadinejad to Auschwitz. And I was very polite, and we prepared the YouTube video, 10 minutes, it's on YouTube, and inviting Ahmadinejad, and I said to him, well, I heard about your conference, and I did that video in 2007, I think February, and I decided that I was going to go in June. I had to set a date. And I said, what if somebody was going to check it out? Maybe he won't come, but somebody else. So I have to be credible and not just pick some dates. And I said, maybe you, I know you're a scientist, but you haven't done a very good investigation or study of the Holocaust. So I would want to invite you to visit Auschwitz with me. I will be in Auschwitz in June, this date to this date, and I want to show you around the camp to see where it happened, because you asked in your conference, where did this thing happen? I said, I was there, and I can tell you my life story, and after I finish it, I want you to look me in the eyes and tell me that this place that you are standing does not exist. I thought this was a pretty interesting idea. I didn't think he would really respond to it, but I still think it was a good idea to... His staff has written me 3 emails, because we sent it by email to him, attached it. And they said, may the Almighty God bless you. I said, well, I'll take any blessings instead of cursing. I guess that would be okay. But you know, I have done a lot of unusual ideas. And even when I was going to meet with this Nazi doctor, I did not know it was going to work out. Because you don't really know when you are embarking on an uncharted territory. It's scary. You're unsure, but there is also the possibility of discovering something new, of learning something new about ourselves. And I wish that Ahmadinejad would come. We can still send him the invitation again. We are going this year. How about that, Rob? Or Rocky, what do you...
He missed the deadline for the cheaper deal. The $100 discount, but he missed the discount.
Well, yeah, maybe we need to send an invitation, and could you just have a piece of paper and everybody here sign it and attach it to the invitation? Wouldn't that be interesting? American citizens, we are inviting you to join us in Auschwitz, or a tour of Auschwitz. That is different diplomacy than kill him with kindness.
Yeah.
Don't say anything bad about him. I wonder really, what do these people think when they are so bullheaded? They're explaining that we are doing something wrong, and they keep their people in prison, no freedom, and you have to be a Muslim, and everybody else is wrong. But there's so much poverty in Iran, such a rich country. So it's interesting how they would answer it, but as an organization, Kiel, should we do that?
Should we invite them?
Yes.
The ironic side note that you forgot to mention was that after you posted that YouTube video, somehow Google and YouTube associated Mahmoud Ahmadinejad with Campbell's Holocaust Museum.
Yeah.
Now we get letters for Mahmoud Ahmadinejad at Campbell's Holocaust Museum. maybe we can say, hey, we're forwarding your mail.
When you go into these areas, you never know what will happen. And now and then it might work. You know, we are going to have a lot of interesting people, and radio personality. We will have a television reporter from Terre Haute. It would be interesting to record those.
We can also get, you're trying to get Gene Simmons from KISS too, right? No, seriously.
Yeah, yeah, really? But,
well,
but Gene.
I could come too then.
You would. You like Gene Simmons? Did you know that Gene Simmons' mother is a survivor of Auschwitz?
That's why I said that. There's a connection between Terre Haute, the KISS Army, which was a fan club for KISS, started by somebody in my high school 2 years older than me. And so there was a book, you should tell the story, but she got an email from somebody writing a book, an unauthorized autobiography or a biography of Gene Simmons. And
Rosberger.
From the University of California, Northridge.
Rosberg. And he wanted my words of wisdom about forgiveness. And
he was going to use your statement in the back of the book.
Right, right.
And so she tells me that she's going to be in a book about KISS. And I said, Mom, in 1977, you did not let my sister and I go to the KISS concert. And everybody, all my classmates went, and I felt terrible that I couldn't go because my parents didn't want me to go because all the KISS people going to the concert were drug addicts.
They did.
So now she said, oh, this guy, this KISS, Gene Simmons, he's the greatest thing since sliced bread.
I didn't say he was the greatest thing since sliced bread. What?
Yeah. Well, so.
But it would be an interesting meeting of Ahmadinejad meeting Gene Simmons.
Yes.
You bring Dennis Rodman along with you.
Dennis Rodman is a painful face to look at. Now, why on earth would people put these big rings? I would like to grab one of those rings and pull him. Maybe whip some common sense into his mind.
On this trip to Poland, there will be Doug Cameron, who played in 1969 Mexico City with the Doors. He played the piano.
Oh, really?
Yeah, he'll be on the trip with Eva.
Really?
Yes. Who?
Doug Cameron.
There's a group, famous group called the Doors, like the Doors. And so he was in the group.
He was for only 1969 this summer.
Doug Cameron was?
Doug Cameron is a...
Was a rock...
He was
rock.
An assistant road manager.
He's a strange guy.
Doug Cameron? Well, he's on your trip.
I know, but I'll tell you why he's strange. He came to Terre Haute for the... What did we have?
Inquest.
No, it was Thomas Blass. And he brought some of his memorabilia. And he told our secretary that he was hoping that Eva would buy it.
Well, I think Gene Simmons gave him the drugs to make him who he is today.
Bill Simmons, do you have any questions for Eva?
Oh, I was just reminiscing on the fact that my son Patrick still uses Gene as his first name on some of his email. In fact, he has an email account that's Gene Simmons.
Really, your son?
Yes. And
why is
and
that?
Because in college he played air guitar to KISS.
Oh, so he was a big fan.
He was a big fan.
How about you?
not,
how did
not so much.
How did you feel about it?
Not so big.
Not weren't sold on. Anybody who paints their face and sticks their tongue out 2 miles, how can he be? I mean, isn't that a strange? Isn't that disrespectful? He made millions. I know, and his music might have been wonderful, but wouldn't he be any less of a music if he didn't stick his tongue out?
Marketing.
Oh, that's a gimmick.
Yes.
So it's an interesting gimmick. You think that otherwise he wouldn't have gone to his concert?
His tongue is a gimmick. A friend of mine in Central Europe in December told me that he believes that events like the Holocaust can happen again in Europe.
today. I was surprised.
I agree with it. I can tell you that Jews in Sweden, Malmö, Sweden, where the population is, I think, 30% Muslim immigrants, Jews are afraid to walk the streets, and they have been beaten up, and the police is afraid to stand up to them. Now, if the police is not going to stand up to them, who will? In France, it's been going on for at least 10 years. I have read different articles in some magazines where they have done some exposés. Why would the police be afraid to go and enforce the law? And they are picking on the Jews. Why the Jews? Why not? This is a minority, and they are blaming Israel for the Arab Palestinians' problems. For your information, how many of you know, and Professor Rob, not Professor, teacher Rob, do you know that no Arab country except Jordan will give Palestinian children whose parents or grandparents or ancestors were from Palestine citizenship if they were born there?
You should tell the reason why you know this.
We were on a trip back from Auschwitz.
Very interesting trip.
You can tell.
So we get on the plane, we're tired, and we're in Poland.
In Warsaw.
And somebody sits next to my mom, and he was obviously not an American, obviously from the Middle East.
No, I didn't know it was from the Middle East.
So he sits down and she says, "Hi, how are you?" And he goes, "Good." And of course she's inquisitive.
No, he said something else. He wanted to help me take my suitcase and put it up. I said, "I cannot reach it up there. I want it under my seat." I am paying for a lot of the trip, for him, mine, and some other people. And I get the worst seat on the flight.
It's in the middle.
It's in the middle of the middle aisle.
So
I can't reach that tall thing there. So I said, no, I want it here below and I can have it. It's not a heavy suitcase. So if I need to get into it and get something out over the flight. I said, "You have an accent." He said, "Yes." I said, "What is your accent?"
So he answers, "I'm Palestinian." And as soon as he does this, I hit her with my elbow.
And elbowing me repeatedly.
I said, "Check it," which means quiet, don't talk. Because I knew this was World War III. We got 9 hours on the flight, right? So I get her to go to sleep. And then about 2 hours later.
No.
Well, about an hour later.
No.
Looking at some of the clippings of the trip. And I see him looking over her shoulder, reading the clippings, and then she notices that, and then next thing you know, they start talking again. I thought, oh my God.
But actually, I said to him, I argued with him, I said, "What do you mean you are a Palestinian? Were you born in Palestinian part of Palestine, or where were you born?" He said, "I was born in Saudi Arabia." I said, "If you were born in Saudi Arabia, then you are Saudi Arabian." He said, "No, my great-grandfather, left Jaffa at the independence war and settled in Saudi Arabia. He was a teacher." And he said, "There is a law in the Arab countries that any children born to ancestry, Palestinian ancestry, cannot be given a citizenship." I said, "What is written on your passport?" I'm getting angry with that guy. He said, "Refugee." I thought to myself, that is terrible. No human being on the face of this earth should be a refugee for life. And I can tell you that as you work on genocide prevention, there should be a country in the world that will give a citizenship to all those people who are called refugees. And that United Nations has not done anything about it. And the countries of the world have not done anything about it. Because he even told me, he said, we are at least 7 million children, grandchildren, and great-grandchildren of Palestinian ancestry. There is no way for us to go back to Israel. There is not enough room. It was done to keep a live army ready against Israel. And it was done by the Arab countries on purpose.
What he told my mom. This is not my mom's opinion.
Yeah.
He was very, very forthcoming.
His name is Yasser.
Yasser
and Kiel met him, right?
Everybody, the end of the trip, everybody's coming up and wrote pictures.
See, these are the adventures that you encounter when you go with me. You meet a Yasser.
And you ended up buying corn syrup from him.
Yes, I did.
He's an engineer for Procter & Gamble, and he was trying to get Polish citizenship because he's married with 3 kids, and he wants his kids to have a country to call home. So it was Poland or Canada. The United States was going to be too tough for him.
But that, I think, most people do not know that children and grandchildren and great-grandchildren of Palestinians are refugees for life, forever. And I thought that is, but what kind of an animosity it creates in the hearts of those people? Because I was just born, why should I be a refugee for life? So they are angry, definitely.
When don't the Palestinians in Israel have more rights than Palestinians in any of the Arab countries surrounding Israel?
Yes. I went to Israel last time, 14 months ago, December 2011, and I took with me a reporter, a videographer, and a friend from New York who wants to write a screenplay about my life, Gianna Garel. And also a board member came, and it was, we arrived Friday night. Now, Friday night, most of you don't know, but in Israel, all the stores, all the restaurants, everything is closed. Shabbat, that's correct. So I had reserved a condo in Jaffa, which is right, because we stayed there, it had security posts. They are about height of maybe 30 inches countertop height, that they are posts, concrete posts, all around the building. So if a suicide bomber would approach it with a car, with bomb, it could blow up and not really harm anybody in the condo. So I liked that part. And as you open your window, you can see the Mediterranean beach. And it was also very helpful to us. It was security-wise good. We had one living room, a kitchenette, and 4 bedrooms and 2 baths. So the guys got 1 bathroom and the girls got it. And we could sit in the living room, put our equipment, and discuss what was going to be the plan of the day for going and filming. So it was much more attractive than in a hotel room. And that was, we went to see some of the twins. But what I wanted to tell you, Friday night, we went to eat in an Arab restaurant. Right there, we walked to Jaffa, and there were restaurants with wonderful food. And next to us was a young man with his wife. She had a Sharia covering on her head, and a little bouncing, I think about 8 months old little boy. And I asked him in English, do you speak English? And he said, yes. Of course, he looked just like anybody else, Western. He didn't look Arab. And always amazing to me that the women look Arab and the guys wear normal Western clothes. But anyway, and I said, he said, I work for Doctors Without Borders. I am from Jerusalem, and we came to Jaffa to have dinner, and then we are going to go visit some relatives. and there was no police, nothing. And we ate the Arab restaurant a couple of times, because on Saturday morning or lunch, we again could not go to a Jewish restaurant. So we ate there. And it's all free, the area, I mean, no police, nobody's, and they prosper, and I think that they are doing pretty well. So that's what somebody said, that the Arabs probably in Israel are doing better than in any other Arab country, to the best of my knowledge. What I like, and I don't want to pick on Muslims, but I would like to say the following. In the heart of Tel Aviv, there is a brand new big mosque overlooking the Mediterranean beach. And I thought, wow, I have not seen that before. I said, wouldn't it be nice if in Cairo, in any of the big Arab capitals or cities, there would be a synagogue, a nice big new church? That is not happening. It's not happening. So we are just going by what we know. They want equality, but they want more than equality. They want to push their religion on others. And equality means everybody has the right. Yes?
I'd like to suggest something about your story about Yasser and the Palestinians.
Yeah.
I think it's interesting. Would it be safe to say that you had some prejudices, or at least preconceived notions,
sure,
about Palestinians?
Sure.
And it wasn't until you actually had a conversation with this fellow and learned his story that some of those went away and you...
Well, but he yeah, that is true. And I felt sorry for him because he's a human being, and this is what really is, that a human being should have the same right as I have, that eventually I can live as a free person in this world. And how is it that the powers who are ruling the world do not help him to have an opportunity to live as a free person? Unless he finds a country where he can become a citizen. And in the meantime, if any of these people growing up in Arab countries, no wonder they are angry with the world, they have to take it out on us, who have freedom. They have no idea what freedom is. Everything is imposed on them. So I think that if there would be United Nations, if they ever could do one thing right, they ought to make a country somewhere that would give a citizenship. Or even the United Nations could have a citizenship, that no person on the face of this earth ever born is born and dies as a refugee.
So as you were telling that story,
yeah,
one of the things that came to mind for me was, and I believe the ship was named the St. Louis, but it could be the,
yeah, the Voyage of the Damned.
This is Mike Bush, the one that...
Oh, hi, Mike.
Last time I met you was at a tennis tournament in Tarawa.
How many years ago was it?
1981.
Yeah, maybe.
Wow. I was just 3 years old.
Yeah, something like that. But anyway, but as I'm listening to that, thinking of that story and them being turned away and turned,
yeah,
away.
Right.
And I'm thinking that...
Yeah. Exactly. The Jews did not have any place to go and live. And the only thing that I can say, that was a strange thing. I was lecturing recently at a medical conference.
Houston.
It wasn't in Houston. I think it was in Chicago just a few weeks ago. And it was at Advantage.
Christ Adventist Hospital.
Right,
right. Oakland Hospital.
And it was open to, I don't know, the guy's only question that I got, he stood up and he said, started mumbling, and he said, where are the Palestinians? And I said, excuse me, this is a conference about medical ethics. This is a very inappropriate question. I don't even know how he knew that I was speaking there and how he got in. I have no idea. But I said, basically, you are trying to push here a political agenda. I can say to you one thing, that I am very, very proud that not one single survivor of the Holocaust ever used the idea that their property was taken away. My property was taken away. Millions of people's property was taken away to justify to kill another human being. Then why on earth are you justifying in the eyes of the world? And why does the world join in and helping you justify killing people because your property was taken away? And I don't even know if it was taken away or not, but let's assume that it's so. Second thing, you, the Palestinians, are not the only refugees that were ever created in the world. And you are really monopolizing the world's sympathy in killing other people. That should never be an excuse for killing. I got a standing ovation for that. Because he thought that I was one of those softy, liberal Jews who would fall overboard. I know what's going on in Israel. I live there. But the fact is, I would never feel right in killing another person because they took my land away. And nobody else should. And that is what they are doing. Okay, we are getting into politics even when I didn't plan.
That's where I cut her off, no politics. That's my purpose here.
No, it's Alex, right? Monitoring me. He's my son. So, my son and my critique.
Do you have a question?
Well, I was actually going to ask Alex a question. You talked about being part of a group of Auschwitz survivors. What's it been like for you being the son of an Auschwitz survivor? I mean, did she have like PTSD while you were growing up? I mean, you couldn't go to KISS concerts and things like that.
Post-traumatic stress.
What were you dealing with and going?
Yeah, that's a great question. So I lectured today at the high school, and it's kind of part of what I talk about a lot. Let me try to answer this way. Years ago, I lived in Denver, Colorado, and I went to a meeting of second generation Holocaust survivors, children whose parents were Holocaust survivors. And I basically went because I was new in town, I didn't know anybody, and I thought I'd meet some people. And so there were about 15 or 16 people there, and each person kind of told a story, and at the end of their story, each one basically said they tried to commit suicide. So I'm the last one to speak, and when it gets to me, I said, well, I think I'm going to be the odd person here, and you're going to think I'm crazy, but I've never thought about committing suicide. If anything, I always think of the Holocaust or being a child of Holocaust survivors as a strength. It's allowed me to persevere over a lot of adversity in my life, and if anything, it's an added bonus. And so as far as the thought of me or other children of Holocaust survivors having post-traumatic stress disorders, I think, and what I learned after speaking with all these survivors, or their children of survivors, most of the Mengele twins were aged 3 to 13. So their kids, me and my sister, are much younger. When I was at this meeting, all these children of Holocaust survivors, their parents were much older, at least 10 to 15 years older than my parents. So they were 10 to 15 years older than me. So their parents had a life before the Holocaust. They had kids, they had wife, husband, and they lost part of those families. So when they came to the United States after the war, they started new families, and they had new children, and a lot of times they thought they were doing their kids a favor by hiding their past. And I've done a lot of reading. There's a book by Helen Epstein called Turner of the Holocaust. And when I was young, and when my sister and I were young, any questions that we had, more my mother than my father, would be answered. If I would ask, somebody asked me today what kind of questions would I want to have answered, and then maybe these other children of Holocaust survivors did not, just simple things. I would ask my mom, why do you have a number, and why doesn't Daddy not have a number? And the reason is my dad wasn't in Auschwitz, my mom was in Auschwitz. So just silly unanswered questions that a 6, 7, 8-year-old should know if they want to ask them, and I don't think these particular children of Holocaust survivors had the same answers to those questions. So And every time I've met with other children of Mengele twins, they're all my age because their parents were the same age. So, and it's that's just my, and I've done a little reading. I'm not a psychologist. I'm a podiatrist. But from the standpoint of having post-traumatic stress disorder, I don't have that.
Or has any more her with the PTSD and how that might impact kids or anything?
She doesn't have it. I mean, my father is a little different story. My father was in camp for 4 years, and when I was a kid, he didn't talk much about the past. And then in 1995, she opened up a museum. He retired as a pharmacist. So he was forced. She said, you need to work in the museum 2 days a week. I don't care if anybody comes in. And so initially, he wouldn't talk at all. And then one group came in, and he started telling a story. So I think he probably...
No, you cannot shut him up.
You can't shut him up. He'll tell you, no, I don't talk about it. 30 minutes later, he has a microphone in his hand. He's not giving it up. So to answer, what was it like growing up in Terre Haute? I'll answer that in another way. When I was in 7th or 8th grade, we had a swim event for school, and we were swimming, and I got to the locker room late, and these two kids beat me up, and they were to call me Dirty Jew. And that was really one of the first experiences I had being a Jew in the United States and having problems. When I was, we had Halloween issues. I don't know if you've seen the movie Forgiving Dr. Mengele, but kids in Terre Haute around Halloween would throw corn at the house. Well, at our house, that became a major issue because my dad would sit and watch TV and sports. My mom would run around the neighborhood chasing these kids. The next day at school, they would say, well, what are you doing? Oh, well, Mrs. Kor's crazy. We're going to go, you know, cause havoc over there. And she would call their parents, and the parents would say, oh, let them, they're just having fun. So now things would come full circle because those kids, my contemporaries, their kids now come in the museum and learn about prejudice. So it's been an interesting journey. And so I don't know if I answered your question or not. I tend to ramble like her, but she goes in tangents and then she forgets where she started.
Alex, do you want tea?
Tea would be better. Okay. Yeah, sorry.
Can you talk about Halloween in your house growing up?
Yeah, I mean, Halloween, like I just mentioned, was...
Well, but I need to add to that after you finish, okay?
Okay, I'll give you the floor. Halloween, you know, I think I was in 5th grade or 4th grade, and we came home from a PTA meeting, and we had a swastika on our house.
Not one.
Multiple. And, you know, I have a sister who's 2 years younger, and it affected me, but it affected me more because it affected my mom. And so, and my dad was one of these, he's still somewhat passive, but he wasn't going to put up a fight. And so for her, in, you know, as a 4th or 5th or 6th grader, I had a tough time understanding it because I just said, why can't she be like all the other parents? But she would not, you know, ignore it. This because if she ignored it, this was what her father did back in Germany, Romania. So she, like I said, would chase these kids around the neighborhood. She would hide behind trees. I can remember it like it was yesterday. And, you know, now I look back, it's funny, but it wasn't funny then. And so finally, after 2 or 3 years...
It wasn't funny now either.
No, but, I mean, the thought of your mother hiding behind a tree and chasing fourth graders around is a little out there, correct?
No.
So, well, let me finish. So, and then when I was between 6th and 7th grade, we moved to a different part of town, and then my mom got the bright idea to go to Israel for the whole month of October. So out of sight, out of mind. And so they would throw, you know, corn at the house. My dad was there. You know, he was watching the news. There was no ESPN at the time. So it didn't bother him. So Halloween, it was a very tough situation for me because, you know, these kids were my contemporaries. And when you're that age, you're affected by your peers. And I was very embarrassed by my parents. And so, you know, it was tough.
Yeah.
Now what are you going to add? You're looking for...
Yeah, I am looking for something.
Okay, something. And I don't know if I... Did I answer Rocky what... She's looking for something to put in there.
So, Eva, one question that came up today, and I thought I knew the answer to this, but
yeah.
One of the general surgeons here in town has 2 sets of identical twins, along with an older child. Mm-hmm. And she was wanting to come to the talk, but she was wanting... You and Miriam were identical twins, is that right?
To the best of my knowledge, yes.
Did they screen for identical twins versus fraternal twins?
In Auschwitz, mm-hmm. They couldn't tell right from wrong. How on earth could they tell? What they really wanted to understand is how to create multiples, and they didn't care if they were identical twins or not, so they collected fraternal twins. And I don't know if there is a way today we have DNA. And I'm wondering, really, doc, you're a doctor. Is a DNA of identical twins identical?
I don't know if anybody...
Anybody knows that question?
I think we'll get back to you on that. I don't think anybody knows that.
What? The smartphone?
Yeah, Google it.
Ainsley says it's so, and I believe her. So.
Yeah.
So in those days they didn't have DNA. But I will go back to the Halloween because that is his perspective, and every story has at least two perspectives. This is what happened. In 1943, just before we were taken away, kids in the neighborhood, in our village, would harass us sometimes, not only for hours, but a couple of days, nonstop. Dirty Jews throw tomatoes, eggs, whatever they could. And we couldn't even leave the house. It was that dangerous looking. And in those days, I asked my father to go outside and make them stop it, because it felt so intimidating and so dangerous that to me it was very difficult to cope with it. I often describe it like being in a house that's on fire and you cannot get out. Well, here I am in wonderful Terre Haute, Indiana. My wonderful son Alex is 6 years old, Mr. Popularity. And he has lots of friends, and they would often come and say, "Mommy, could we have some cookies for Joey, for Mikey, for Eric?" I mean, there was an endless. He was very, very popular. Well, Halloween rolled around, and he's in first grade. And kids, all of a sudden, I come home from work. I work part-time, and I remember it like today. A bunch of corn was thrown at our window. We lived in Park Street. And I said to my husband, "Nikki, what on earth is that?" "Oh, just kids are making some tricks, having fun." So I went outside, and I decided that this was where kids in Romania or Hungary, occupied Romania, having fun on us, and my father wouldn't go outside to stop it. So I could not let that happen. I went outside and tried to chase them away. Well, next day I had three times as many kids. I became a very, very important target. It was wartime. And no matter what I did, and what I really did not understand, and I still have difficulty today. Why would wonderful parents teaching their children give them money and tell them to go outside and have fun on somebody else's account? Is that educationally a positive thing to do? Never, in my opinion, we should never ever have fun on somebody else's account. We could have fun on our own account in normal life. I had fun when the Nazis were hiding from the bombing. That was fun. But this is not a normal situation. I mean, I was glad to see the big bullies hiding for safety. But that is another situation. So it got very bad. It didn't get any better. I even had the audacity, and courage is definitely one thing that I don't lack. I wrote a letter to the editor that I didn't understand how nice people would bless their children, give them money to buy corn and toilet paper and soap to have fun on other people's account. Well, from there on, I think I had only two friends left in Terre Haute. And one of them was Kathy Baker, and the other one was Mrs. Knapp, and she said to me, the Knapps brought my husband to their house. Child, don't get so excited, but they don't really understand it. I support you. I think you're right, but you're not going to win that war. But it lasted 11 years. It wasn't just a little fluke. I wanted to talk to parents. And I told them that I will give their children all the treats that they can have, but I cannot deal with the tricks. And then those parents said, oh, you are some crazy, stupid, crazy survivor. I said, I'm a survivor, but I am not crazy. There was no information available on the Holocaust. No one really knew what we survived. Nor did the children understand. I never made a secret to my children of what happened. But I think I always try to keep it age appropriate. And I can tell you that if NBC wouldn't have had the show Holocaust, I would have never gotten liberated from the harassment in Terre Haute. Because there was nowhere to, when you are a victim, I even talked to the chief of police. He said, well, you can catch them, but just a misdemeanor. And this is when I was standing outside, hiding in the bushes, and trying to catch one of those kids to call the police. Here it is. That was the reason. You didn't know that, did you?
No. Did you see a difference in the way in which people looked at you as a survivor in Terre Haute after? Because the Holocaust movie, I remember, was kind of the first big national.
78,
yeah.
Correct.
Did you see a difference in
To the point where even today, on occasion, I get people who haven't seen me since then will write to me a letter or tell me I'm so sorry. Immediately after that, those kids who called me crazy, wrote me letters. If they met me, saw me at the grocery store, they would come up to me and apologize. We didn't have any idea that just a week ago or so, we got a, there is one of Alex's friends, Paul Frederick, who was one of the kids harassing us. He lives now in
Singapore.
And anytime we have an event, he always sent $1,000 contribution because he saw the film. And Chevron is always matching those funds.
Chevron Oil.
Chevron Oil, he works for them. So they are matching the fund because he didn't know what he was doing. And they finally understood that I was not crazy, that I had a lot to deal with. And often people think, oh, Mrs. Kor has got it made. Well, I finally, nobody's harassing me. That's nice, very nice. But I still don't like Halloween. I try to have a lecture or leave for that occasion. I think that children should have an opportunity to have fun, but not fun on other people's account. So the little ones, fine, but many of the kids come, they're taller than I am, and they probably are much older than junior high. What?
You're not very tall.
Yeah, it's easy to be taller than I am.
She used to be 5'9" when I was a kid, but now she's
not. You mentioned NBC and the impact that show had. Here in Montana, we've actually got one of the main producers of Schindler's List lives up in New
really?
York, Montana, Henry Mullen.
Well, it helped. It helped Alex, and it helped me. It restored me the peace of mind.
He had a question.
Yeah.
Well, I guess what impact did that have for you? What impact did Schindler's List?
Schindler's List, I didn't know anything about Schindler's List. I can tell you an interesting, because every story becomes interesting. In 1991, the Holocaust Museum in Michigan, Southfield, Michigan, I went there because my daughter was in Ann Arbor, so she said, well, Mom, let's go to that museum. They met me, and they were asked me if I would give them an interview, and I did, and then they decided to take five Holocaust survivors from five camps. One of them was Treblinka, one of them was Majdanek, Auschwitz, and two were from Plaszow camp. And we went with them, we toured those places. And they talked about their experiences. Where the Plaszow camp, which became the Schindler's, where the factory was not there, but the Plaszow was a ghetto where the camp was, or the set. You know, the memorial is there now. So we went, and it was cow pastures. We were had to watch where we put our foot down. It was that bad, and they explained that used to be the Plaszow camp. So in 2007, we are going to, not in 2007.
Yeah,
in 2010. Wasn't it not 2010?
2007, they hadn't renovated it yet.
Right, 2007, right. I wanted to take my group for Auschwitz to the place where the Schindler's List was, and I didn't know how to describe it. I said to the place where the Schindler List
the factory was.
I did not know that there was a factory. Because when I went there with the survivors, they did not take us to the factory. At times, it placed to be dumb. And they took us to the factory where the actual factories exist. And I was so, it was an amazing tour. Now it's renovated and doesn't look half as good as it was the old factory where you could see everything with the sink spilling from the ceiling. Yeah.
We had a guy, I don't know if he was security, but he opened up the door. He said, well, they're renovating this for a museum. And we actually saw probably not, I mean, it was very authentic and before they'd made it into a museum.
So. Yeah. So every time something happens when we go to Auschwitz.
So I remember, you know, when I first remember kind of hearing some of you, and I've kind of known your story ever since I've known Alex in some way.
And what did he tell you? My mother is crazy.
But what I really remember when it really became kind of a bigger thing was when the hunt for Dr. Mengele was on.
Oh, gosh. Now that's another completely very, very big issue. What? Yeah.
No, all for it. Talk.
The hunt for Mengele.
The hunt for Mengele. Well, I will try to maybe give it a Reader's Digest version.
Clip notes.
In 1985, we the Mengele twins finally made our presence in the world known by returning to Auschwitz, and NBC actually reporting it. So that same year, by June, the United States Justice Department issued a report that Mengele's bones were found in Embu, and was in Embu, Brazil, and he died in 1979. There was no information given to us, the survivors, and we were never consulted on the conclusion of that preliminary report. But the results of those preliminary reports were very final, because all effort in finding Mengele or any attention or help that we the survivors needed disappeared by magic, it was gone. So the effects of it were completely different. Many of the survivors just started grappling with their memories and having enough courage to raise their heads and try to remember and talk about it. So it was a big problem. Well, I never accepted, because it was too perfect the way it was done. Just too perfect, it didn't make any sense. So I said, fine, maybe these are Mengele's bones, but we the survivors should have an opportunity to at least sit down as civilized people, look at the information, have some experts, and help us analyze it. So I mortgaged my home because I couldn't raise a penny and have a conference in Terre Haute. We invited everybody who was somebody, from the Justice Department to the forensic pathologist to the German officials who were involved in it, Israel. And we put together a little committee. We had about 7 people on the panel. We had among them also an attorney, Gerald Posner. And we had Dr. Michael Baden from New York. He came. And there was a profile of Mengele. What was very interesting is that the first hour or so, we had the forensic report, and I made a copy. We had about, I think, 500 copies made. We distributed it to the public. We also sent a complete report to every member of Congress. And Dr. Lowenstein, who was a German-educated Jewish doctor who was in Terre Haute, and he was my doctor, and actually got his medical degree from the same university as Mengele did, he stood up, and you have to understand Dr. Lowenstein, very proper, as most Germans are, very proper and exactly the same person should be. And he said to me, Eva, what is that conference? Inquest. These doctors who did the forensic study, they have titles and they have degrees. How can you, a housewife, realtor from Terre Haute, Indiana, dispute that? I said, Dr. Lowenstein, I don't know how I can dispute it, but I want to understand it. And I do not understand how fast they could come up with a conclusion for that. He said, okay, I'll be on your panel. But he was a reluctant person. He stood up. This guy who was debating why I'm even doing it stood up within half an hour after he read the forensic report. And he said, these bones cannot be Mengele's. Mm-hmm. I looked at him. He said, Eva, remember, I translated the Mengele file for you. And there it said that Mengele suffered of osteomyelitis.
Bone infection.
In 1926 or 27, when X-ray technology was very primitive, was it in infancy? And it had to be, therefore, be a really badly scarred bone to show up. He said, there is nowhere in that report. Is there any report of hole in the bones? Because of that, they kept trying to prove that Mengele, those were Mengele's bones until 1992. In 1992, a Dr. Alex Jeffries from Leicester University in England was going to do the DNA study. That was another little fiasco. The Mengele family, they needed bone samples from Irene Schoenbein Hackenjaw, who was Josef Mengele's first wife, and from Rolf to see if the DNA of the bones found in Embu matched, has some family resemblance. I don't know how they do the DNA.
Rolf's the son. Rolf is,
we are trying to meet him this summer. Oh, I would like to make a hop from Auschwitz to Ginsburg, but I don't think it will work. Because so far, I haven't been able to find any connection with him. Anyway. I wrote to Dr. Jeffries and asked for a report, and he sent me 2 reports. I also wrote to Eberhard Klein, who was a German prosecutor who was going to have the press conference for the DNA report with Dr. Jeffries, Alex Jeffries. And then I called him, and he kept moving the date of the press conference. Miriam was trying to help me from Israel because she has connections in what was going on, and he lied through his teeth. And what I really objected to was that not one single member of the press that was present would ask a simple question. Was there an independent study to find out where the bones came from? If somebody says these are Mengele's bones, is that enough for the world to accept it? Was there anybody else who took a sample of those bones? And was there anybody independent of the official study? There should have been at least three studies, in my opinion. One American, one Israeli, and one German, maybe. And if they wanted a fourth, could be a Brazilian one. But there was never any verification of where the bones and the blood came from. So in other words, all Dr. Jeffries could say that the bone and the blood came from the same family because he could not verify. And that's what I was objecting to. That's why I wanted to be present at the press conference. So then the United States Justice Department had a forensic report or a final report in October of 1992, and it says, in the matter of Josef Mengele, a report of the United States Criminal Division, Office of Special Investigation, a report to the Attorney General of United States. Well, I found that nobody told me anything about it. I found out about it. A reporter called me from Chicago. He got the forensic report and the conclusion of the DNA. And what was my opinion about it? I told him I didn't know anything about it, but I would love to have a copy. So he made me a copy. I read it. And on page 168, it says that the stepson of Mengele, Karl Heinz Mengele, and the attorney for the Mengele factory, Hans Sedermeier, went to see a doctor by the name of Hans Munch after Mengele's purported death to ask him if Josef Mengele would be found guilty for the experiments, for the selection, or both. Well, I didn't know what the word purported was. It was a word I never encountered before, so I studied, I looked it up in the dictionary in two or three different times. So it meant that he supposedly was dead. In other words, the Mengele family went to ask Dr. Munch if Josef Mengele's corpse would be found guilty for the experiments, for the selection, or both. Well, that to me is absurd. If he's dead, nobody really cares if he's guilty or not. So why would, and this was the other reason that when the opportunity came to meet Dr. Munch, I was very, very excited. And I did ask him this question. I have it on a cassette somewhere in my house. It was not recorded. It was recorded by the television that recorded everything, but they edited it. It was RTL television from Holland, and they didn't know what on earth they were doing. And Dr. Munch said clearly, they told me they came zweimal, which means twice. And they told me that Mengele was alive and well, but was tired of hiding. And that was in 1982, which means, in other words, that he couldn't have been buried in Embu, Brazil in 1957. So that is another very long story. But I can tell you that in Germany, I went to Günzburg. Last time I was there in 2007, I was there with a German lady who went with me to a conference to Würzburg, and I knew from a previous trip that in Germany, everybody who is born is entered in a book, and then by their name, date of death. Well, we studied that. We were there, and a cab driver pointed out that Mengele would be dead, and he could prove it to us because he looked at the record, and he was stunned in 1991 that there was no date of death. Well, in 2007, there still was no date of death because I went with Gunda, and the little secretary said, well, I'm not permitted to show you the page. You have to be a family member to see Mengele's page. I said, okay, can you read it to me? Is there any rule against it? Yeah. Well, I'm not just a survivor. I have to survive anything and everything. He said, no, there is no rule against it. So he read, said he was born March 16, 1911, and I said, died. She said, there is no date of death. His two brothers have date of death, but Mengele doesn't. There will be someday date of death, and I want to find out about it. But that is basically in a very short form.
That wasn't so short, but it was good.
All right, so do you have any questions to me? You young people, the young generation. Am I boring you to death?
I mean, you get little bits and pieces of it, but actually hearing it from like firsthand is just amazing. So
who is going with me to Auschwitz? The two of you? Now see your holes in the jean prevent. I am sorry. I'm going to stop. I'm going to behave from now on. Yeah. And so you're junior, right?
Yeah.
So that's a senior thing. That's good. All right, I think we have time. Okay.
Tell us about forgiveness.
Oh, forgiveness.
Yes.
We didn't even. Forgiveness, first of all, my forgiveness for all those people and Jewish people. There is Danny Spangen. He's my friend. Yeah, there he is. Okay. For Jewish people who do not believe in forgiveness or forgiving the Nazis. It has my forgiveness. I don't think anybody really understands it because it has nothing, absolutely zero, to do with the perpetrator. Forgiveness is for the sake of helping the victim. Now, I heard as I was living in Terre Haute, Indiana, that Christians were forgiving because Christ said that is good, but I was not a Christian. It did not apply to me. I am not a Christian, I'm Jewish. So I thought, that's a Christian thing, not a Jewish thing. So I completely ignored it, and nothing would have happened. And that whole event of forgiveness, I am still amazed how that happened. But Miriam died in 1993, June 6th, so it's going to be 20 years this year, and I was devastated by her death. And just to describe to you, I came home one afternoon, on a Sunday afternoon, from an open house as a realtor, and there was a message on my answering machine from Israel, from her husband, telling me, I'm sorry to tell you, but your sister is dead. I immediately called Israel. I was not prepared yet to lose my sister. And I told him that I was going to catch the first flight to Israel that I could, that I have never buried any member of my family. Such a simple human gesture that most people take for granted. And I had a desperate need to touch my sister. In many ways, I think I kind of wanted to verify that she was indeed dead. I've never verified the death of any member of my family. And I wanted to say goodbye to her. And I also wanted to say goodbye to my kidneys that I donated to her 6 years earlier. But my brother-in-law said no, and that was the final no. So I was left.
They were going to bury her that day, and so she couldn't get on the
Because one of my nieces is very religious, and so they were going to bury her within 24 hours. That is according to old customs or religious observances. And I was just devastated. I had nightmares every night. I could exactly feel the way my sister died. And I was trying to function to the best of my ability. And I should eternally be grateful to Dr. John Michalczyk, who, end of June, it was about 3 or 3.5 weeks later, he called me, unrelated to Miriam's death, and he said to me, Eva, I am doing a conference on Nazi medicine at Boston, and I would like you to come and lecture to some doctors. And I told him I love to lecture to doctors. And he said, why is that? I said, well, I go to the doctors, and doctors tell me I'm too fat. I don't eat the right food. I don't exercise enough. And after they chew me out, I have to pay them. So I said to him, I would like the good doctors to know what they do wrong, because in my opinion, they do plenty of things wrong. And then after I chew them out, I look forward to them paying me. And he said to me, okay, when you come to Boston, he said, it would be really nice if you could bring with you a Nazi doctor. I was stunned. A Nazi doctor, I said, where do you think I can find those guys? I don't think they're advertising in the yellow pages. Well, he said, you like to joke a lot. I said, yes, I said, I do. I have cried enough, and I think that joking is a lot more fun. He said, think about it, and maybe you come up with some kind of an idea. And I remembered that the last project that Miriam and I worked on together was a documentary done by a German television. We finished it in 1992. In that documentary done by TDF, a German television network, they interviewed 48 of the Mengele twins. And in that documentary, there was a Nazi doctor from Auschwitz. He was not my doctor, I didn't know him, but he was in the documentary, so I figured he might be still alive. So I faxed a letter to Germany, and I told them that Miriam just died, and would they please give me the telephone number of Dr. Munch in the memory of Miriam, because a year before they wouldn't give it to me. And amazingly, an hour or so later, my fax machine was working, and there was a long sympathy letter and Dr. Munch's telephone number. So then I called a friend who speaks German, and I asked him to call Dr. Munch to invite him to the conference in Boston. And he did, and he said, Dr. Munch is not coming to Boston, but he's willing to meet with you at his house in Germany. And he said, the Dutch television will film it, and they will also pay for your expenses if you give them the right to broadcast it in Holland. I said, sure. So I am heading to Germany, July of 1993. And see, from the moment that I agreed to go to Germany, my focus shifted from poor me not being able to attend my sister's funeral and trying to deal with that, to me meeting a Nazi doctor. And how, what was I mean, I felt very nervous, but I also was very curious. I was curious what I might learn about our experiments, because he was a good friend of Mengele's. And second, I was curious, why was he willing to meet with me? So I arrived at Dr. Munch's house. He treated me with the utmost respect, kindness, and consideration. For instance, we were sitting outside on some metal chairs because the light was much better outside. And this old man, 82 years old at the time, not that old because I'm going to be 3 years, 82, come to think of it, he went into the house, brought back 5 pillows, 5 times each time he handed me a pillow. finally I said to him in English, Dr. Munch, what are you doing? He said, I want to make sure that you are comfortable sitting on those chairs. That somehow didn't compute. A Nazi doctor worried about my comfort. It did not compute in my mind. But I understood that he was a different Nazi. He said he didn't know anything about our experiment, that Mengele always said it was top secret. But he gave me a good interview for my Boston conference. So out of the blues, I have no idea where it came from. I will never really understand what happened there. I never thought about it even one single time. I hear myself say, Dr. Munch, by any chance, do you know anything about the gas chambers in Auschwitz? And he said to me, this is a nightmare that I live with every single day of my life, and went on describing the operation of the gas chamber. Now, if we look at it, what are the chances that I meet the only Nazi ever who knew about the gas chambers in Auschwitz? To me, that is an amazing story in itself. So he said people would be told before they entered the showroom to hang their clothes and remember the hanger number so they could retrieve it when they got out of the shower. The shower room was polished, the floors were gleaming, the shower heads were gleaming. They spread a lot of perfume so people would feel comfortable. Once the shower room was packed, the doors would close. And Dr. Munch was stationed outside looking through the peephole. The gas did not come from the shower head. They were there strictly as a camouflage. A hatch-like vent opened in the ceiling. Zyklon B looks like pellets of white gravel. Canister was opened and dropped from the outside, fell to the floor. It operated like dry ice. So the gas was rising from the floor. People were trying to get away as they were suffocating on the gas, climbing on top of each other. What that meant, that the strongest people ended up on the top of the pile. He said when the people on the top of the pile stopped moving, he knew that everybody was dead. And Dr. Munch would sign one death certificate stating 1,000, 2,000, or 3,000 people were murdered. I mean, they kept everything, records of everything. I said to Dr. Munch, this is an amazing story. I have never, ever heard about it. And I am going back to Auschwitz in 1995, and I would like you to come with me and sign a document at the ruins of the gas chamber, and I want it signed in the company of witnesses so nobody could say that you didn't say it and you didn't sign this document. And he immediately said to me, I would love to. Well, I didn't really know it was going to be that easy. See, none of it was planned. This was all, I didn't plan to ask him about the gas chamber. I had no idea what he would say. It was just evolving. So now I am coming back to Terre Haute, Indiana, very, very excited that I will have a document signed, not by a survivor, not by a liberator, but actually by a Nazi who witnessed it. And I wanted to thank this Nazi doctor. I wanted to give him a meaningful gift. And I didn't know where to look. I didn't tell anybody about my ideas. Zero. Nobody knew. So I went to the local Hallmark shop. I thought if I look in the thank you section, maybe I'll get some ideas. I didn't really think that I would find a card for a Nazi doctor. But I thought I would get some ideas because I didn't know where else to turn. Well, I read cards for two and a half hours. And two ladies who worked there came up at different times asking me, how are you doing? Okay, are you finding what you are looking for? I said, not really. Well, what are you looking for? Maybe we can help you find it. I said, no, no. Yeah, I just thought that, oh, I'm looking for a card or a gift for a Nazi doctor. Wasn't going to be. Yeah. So I said to them, no, no. I said, I will just keep on looking. But I really left the card shop because I realized that there was nothing that I could learn. But what I find amazing, that I did not give up the idea of finding a gift, a meaningful gift for this Nazi doctor. So I went back to life lesson number one, which when I lecture, which I will do tomorrow on both lectures, I give three of my many life lessons that I think are the most important. Number one, never ever give up on yourself or on your dreams, because if you give up, nothing will happen. So for the next 10 months, when I was cooking, cleaning, doing the laundry, driving the car, I kept asking myself, and it's an interesting exercise when you have a problem to focus in on that question, what can I give this Nazi doctor? And you will find that if you have a problem, your mind will come up with a lot of answers. I did that for 10 months because none of the answers that I got seemed to be appropriate. And 10 months later, the simple idea, how about a letter of forgiveness from me to him, to Dr. Munch? I knew immediately that this was a meaningful gift. But what I discovered for myself was life-changing because I discovered that I had the power to forgive. No one could give me that power, and no one could take it away. Up to that time, I reacted to what other people did. This was the first time that I made a decision to change the course of my, and have power over my present and over my future. It's an amazing experience. It is, I feel forgiveness, first of all, is a gift I give myself. Second, if anybody wants revenge, forgiveness is the best revenge. Because once you forgive, the perpetrator has no power over you. And perpetrators want to have influence and power over you. When you forgive, all that is gone. Well, I began writing my letter. It took me another 4 months to work through a lot of pain. There are no books written on how to write a forgiveness letter. And finally, I liked what I wrote, and then it occurred to me that somebody might read it someday. And you can find those letters already. I think I talked about that in the Kendall's website on Education Center and then Letters to the World. We talked about that. And so we arrived in Auschwitz with, no, before that. I called my former English professor to correct my spelling. And she said, well, that's very nice that you are forgiving Dr. Munch, but you really need to forgive Mengele. And I tried to dispute that. I said, this is just a little letter. She said, okay, Eva, when you go home tonight, I just want you to think for a moment, how would it make you feel if you could say to Mengele, I forgive you? I thought, okay, an interesting little exercise. And the moment I thought about how would it feel, I said to myself, wow, I, the little nobody from Auschwitz, even has the power to forgive the God of Auschwitz. And I said, and I do. I am not hurting anybody, so why couldn't I do it? And so this is the way we arrived in Auschwitz. Alex was there. There was a lot of worries, and he can talk about that. I never look, which is really maybe I'm very naive and I will die naive. I said, "Mom, I'm taking a Nazi doctor to Auschwitz."
See, the Mengele twins from Israel, by this time my aunt had died, so the Mengele twins from Israel didn't like the idea.
Not only that, I mean, I think that even I find out that the Auschwitz Museum would have liked to know that I brought a Nazi doctor to Auschwitz. Yeah.
So let me tell you a little experience I had here in Billings, and I'm really telling you this because I want you guys to hear this. There was a physician who no longer lives in Billings. He was a specialist, highly respected, highly sought-after doctor. So about 4 years ago, and I considered him a friend. I helped him through some really tough times personally. And in the middle of the emergency department, after he took care of the patient, there wasn't a lot going on. We started having a conversation. And I'm not sure how we got to this conversation, but he proceeded to tell me the Holocaust never happened. And he proceeded to tell me that, yeah, there were a few people that died, and yeah, they did a little bit of this, but there's documentation that there's only 100,000 people that were killed. And this is a person I considered a good friend. And somebody that, you know, and I'm a history nut. I read tons of stuff. And I'm just bored. I try to talk to him about this, and there's no talking to him. And this is 4 years ago from Billings, Montana. Highly educated, highly respected individual. So when you tell your story about Dr. Munch and the letter, I knew the story at that point in time. I tried to tell somebody.
Well, you can find it on our website.
You can't convince.
No, that is the.
But it just was really powerful to me to think that somebody like this, who my previous respect had been up here for, who knows, put it down here. But anyway.
Tell me about presenting the letter to Dr. Munch.
Oh, well, okay, so now we are standing by the ruins of the gas chamber. And it is really a very surreal experience because here I'm standing with a Nazi doctor who I knew that by that time he actually was stationed in the gas chamber outside looking in. He knew nothing about my letter to him. He knew about his letter and he signed it and the witnesses signed it. And then I took out my letter, and I read it. And we signed it. And I gave it to him. And he was stunned. And he thanked me very much. He could not believe that this was possible, that I was forgiving him. But he was very, very grateful that I did. I think, looking back at it, and I am not a religious person, and I don't even know if there is a God or not. I know that most of you do probably. I don't know. But for that to have happened the way it happened, the way it worked out, I have no explanation for it, how it evolved one thing to the other.
You should tell the story about lighting the candles.
Yeah, I'm going there. When we finished the ceremony, we went to the existing crematorium, which now they don't permit us anymore to light candles there. And we were about, I think, 15 in our group. I gave everybody a candle to light. And I felt very awkward giving Dr. Munch a candle because he was there. And I didn't want to put him on the spot. So we all light our candles, and I lit the candle in the memory of my parents, my sisters, my family, and 1.5 million Jewish children who were murdered by the Nazis. Alex lit his candle. And we finished the ceremony, and Dr. Munch comes up to me and said, "Eva, everybody got a candle but me. How come I cannot have a candle?" I said, "Well, I didn't know that you wanted one." But he noticed what was going on. So I'm giving him a candle, and he goes up to the ovens. He said, "I light this candle in the memory of thousands or millions of people I watched in the gas chamber die, take their last breath of air. And you know, for a moment, we all stopped breathing because it was the most profound candle that was statement that was said at that time. And he did. He did. I mean, we were all stunned, and every single person who was there will never forget that moment. So, unfortunately, we didn't record it. We did not have a video running at the time. We were pretty good at some videos, but it wasn't always running. That would have been the moment to record it, really. So that is what forgiveness healed him. Now, I will tell you that in my humble opinion, forgiveness is the secret for world peace. What happens with victims, no victim ever wants to be a victim. I have never seen anybody volunteer to be a victim. So how does a person become a victim? When somebody takes away our power to use our minds or our bodies or both, by force, of course. Therefore, in my opinion, to liberate oneself from it is to forgive and take the only power one left to remove that burden. I call anger a seed for war. I don't think that there was ever a person on the face of this earth who was a very happy person who wanted to start a war. People who forgive, they are at peace with themselves, and therefore they don't want to start a war. Therefore, I call forgiveness a seed for peace. The truth is that we can teach forgiveness. The biggest gift that we could give victims who have been liberated from any oppressive situation is to teach them how to heal themselves. We cannot heal them. Each person has to do it for herself or himself. But we can plant that little seed in their mind that maybe a year, 2, 3, 5, 10 years later, the Holocaust happened almost 70 years ago, and the majority of the survivors are still victims. Isn't that tragic? So I believe if we could teach children in kindergarten, and if anybody has some great, I would like to develop some characters like Charlie, Peanuts, and Lucy, and some, for little kids, cartoon type, because that is a lot easier to teach it to children in nursery school, kindergarten. If we teach forgiveness at that young an age, it becomes a lot more of their makeup personality than if we teach it at age 16 or 18.
So the book you wrote for the little kids, my copy is a Xerox copy.
What?
He has a Xerox copy of Little Eva.
It's a good book, but I would like to develop the same character, cartoon-type characters, that would actually go back to that school and forgive those kids. But it has to be funny. It has to, for children, you cannot be that serious. Yeah. But I like the book, and I think it's a very profound little book. But I didn't get any further because I got very busy. And I'm still very busy. So I need help.
How many twins were first in Auschwitz? How many survived?
1,500 sets of twins, 3,000 individuals. The reason that most of them died were used in experiments like I was used. I was injected with a deadly germ, and I became very ill after one of those injections, and then taken to the hospital. Mengele stood by my bed. I had very high fever. Arms, legs were swollen and painful, and I had huge red patches on my body. Mengele came in next morning and looked at my fever chart. He never examined me and said, laughing sarcastically, "Too bad she's so young. She has only 2 weeks to live." I knew he was right, but I refused to die. So for the next 2 weeks, I was between life and death. And I remember crawling on the barrack floor, fading in and out of consciousness. I was crawling to reach a faucet with water at the other end of the barrack, because this barrack was not allocated any food, nor water, nor medicine. Now, after 2 weeks, my fever broke, and then I felt a lot stronger, and it took me another 3 weeks before I was released from the hospital and reunited with Miriam. Miriam was very sick, and she looked like the living dead I left in the barrack. Dying in Auschwitz was the easiest thing in the world. Surviving was a full-time job. And many people, I would say everybody in Auschwitz was sick at one time or another. Those who gave up the struggle to live one more day, because that's all you could focus in, one more day, were as good as dead. And what would happen? You would see them sitting, looking in space without any will to live. And that was very, very dangerous. And Miriam looked like that when I got back. And I asked her, "What happened to you?" She said, "I cannot talk about it. I will not talk about it." And we did not talk about Auschwitz until 1985. Now, it helped me a little bit, get a little bit of insight of what happened to her, but not exactly. Then we talked, I asked her if she remembered when I was taken to the hospital. And she said, yes. And I said, "Well, what happened to you while I was in the hospital?" She said she was in surrounded by doctors, and they were monitoring her 24 hours a day, and they were waiting for something to happen. They didn't tell her what that was, and she didn't know if it happened or it didn't. But it was the same 2 weeks that Mengele said I was going to die. Would I have died? Miriam would have been rushed to Mengele's lab, killed immediately with an injection to the heart. And the Mengele would have done the comparative autopsies. My diseased body, and Miriam was the control. 1,500 sets of twins that were taken to Auschwitz. The estimated number of survivors was 200 individuals. Most of them died in the experiment.
How old were you?
What?
How old were you?
10. My aunt arrived in Auschwitz, the one that raised us.
Yes.
She worked in a bomb factory. And any of the inmates who worked in factories had a little bit better conditions than the conditions in the camp. They weren't ideal, but they got a little bit more food and was much better than staying in Auschwitz. She was shipped from Auschwitz to a bomb factory. Yep. Her husband didn't survive. He was only 45 years old. No, he was 43 or 44. And her son was 26. Tall, handsome guy. It was the roll of the dice how anybody survived. And my aunt was always the sickly one. How she ever survived, I don't know. I have a theory that probably, a little bit anyway, that those who were the weaker ones who somehow found themselves alive said to themselves psychologically, "Oh, I am alive, so-and-so has to be alive." Because in the back of my mind, I expected somebody else from my family to survive. We were the two youngest, most spoiled brats in the family. To figure out that we were alive, I thought somebody else had to survive. On the other hand, those who were my parents, or if even my, I don't know if my mother was alive for any length of time, it could be, but I don't believe that my father or older sisters were alive, because 90% of the Hungarian transport, that was the last big transport to arrive in Auschwitz, was sent directly to the gas chamber. We arrived in Auschwitz end of May, probably a week before D-Day. The Nazis knew that they were losing the war. Yet they were still bent on killing as many Jews as they could. So I don't know, but maybe if they were alive for a while, they thought if we are alive, maybe the children are alive. I don't know.
How were you reunited with your
family? Well, we arrived back after 9 months in refugee camps in the Soviet Union. We arrived back to Romania and we went to the village. I always wanted to see my house, and I always believed that somebody would come back. The house was ransacked. There, all I could find, there was 3 crumpled pictures on a bedroom floor, and that was all that was left of my family. We stayed in the house, I don't think if it was 3 or 4 hours, when a cousin arrived. And he said, my aunt, Aunt Irena, knew that we were coming back because in big cities they had Jewish centers that they would have updates about people coming back from the death camps. And we were on a list. She immediately recognized who we were. And so she, I don't know if she knew that we would go home, but that is the reason we wanted to come home. I wanted to see my home. Otherwise, we would have ended up, actually, we were in an orphanage and they were going to send us to Palestine. Lucky for me, because those kids who were in the orphanage, they were ultimately ended up in refugee camps in Cyprus because they couldn't enter Palestine. So they were 2 years in behind barbed wire in Cyprus. So I was just basically, I had a lucky or a guardian angel, as I like to call, throughout guiding me. And even with Dr. Munch, I think I had a little guardian angel because that was, to me, the most unbelievable thing that I would meet a Nazi doctor, the only Nazi doctor I ever talked to, was stationed outside the gas chamber.
Do you have any thoughts about the British?
The British? No, none whatsoever. Why?
Well, because they were probably supervising the Cyprus camp. That's why I asked.
Yeah, no, they were also not letting in Jews into Palestine, the British mandate. The powers of the world always had a lot more to do with people being victimized than they really are willing to take. But, you know, if I want to hate the world, I will find enough excuses to last me a lifetime. And what good will it do me? Nothing. See, that whole idea of being angry. I mean, to run this world, they are doing a lousy job, but it's better job than they are doing in the third world countries where women have no right to vote, they cannot drive a car, and they are suddenly considered human beings. They can't even object to somebody marrying them off or having children. So I guess I'm better off.
Okay, I suggest if you give much more of your lecture, there'll be no reason to come tomorrow night.
Now it's the lecture is finished and it's 20 till 11.
No,
I think this.
20 till 9.
Oh, 20 till 9. Oh, 2 hours. Oh.
Till
my time. Well, I have my Terre Haute clock time. Yeah. All right, well, I think you were a very good orient, and thank you for making it possible.
Thank you.
And you got everything you ever wanted to know about the Holocaust, right? And more.
There it is.
Yeah. But life is good. I can still dance the hora if people hold on to me. Yeah.
Viktor Frankl, I'm guessing.
Yes, yes. It's a very, very good book. And the whole idea, and his idea of just having power over your life, finding meaning in suffering, It's so profound. I saw a videotape of him. Somebody handed me. He was lecturing at Mount Sinai Hospital in Los Angeles, and he said that a man came to him in great distress because his wife died and he couldn't live without her. And he said to, just asking, he said, well, what would happen if you died first and your wife would have been the one left? No, it could have happened. He said, oh, he said, she could have never been able to live without me. So suddenly he said, doctor, I realize now it was good that she died first and not me. So he found a meaning in his own suffering. And he left and thanked him. It is really, we have to find meaning in what we do and what happens to us. Because there is meaning, it's just the way we look at things. Yeah, it's always the tragedy for every disaster. It's not for the victim who died, it's the people. Sure, they have to pick up the pieces and go on.
Well, you've done an extraordinary job.
Thank you very much. Yeah.
So,
thank you. Thank you, sir. I appreciate that. Life is tough, but I am tougher.
Yes, I think you are.
Thank you.
Eva, I'd like to get a picture of you and Bill in Maryland, if I could.
Sure.
Because you're the guy who made this possible.
She made it possible. I just happen to be Rocky's friend.
Yeah, and Rocky has a lot of friends. And I met him today, and I said to Rocky, Rocky, you must be somebody important.
He is.
And he said,
on many levels.
And he said, I said, with a name like that, how can you be named Rocky and not be important? I think when his parents gave him that name,
I think probably.
Well, if I stand on that side of you, and then I can.
There's going to be a glare coming off the glass, so maybe in front of the couch.
Okay. We're in Romania.
Transylvania, a tiny, tiny, tiny village.
Okay.
My grandmother was from Romania. Well,
okay. Oh, I don't think we should sit.
No, stand.
Yeah,
stand
yeah. Okay. Okay.
By the way, you know what? No, because then I'm going to get the backs of your heads in the mirror. So, right here.
Oh, okay. Where? Oh, yeah, I see. There is a mirror.
You can
I'm going to stand on this side of you, and then I can put my
cast behind. I'm going to stand a little bit behind and let the two short ladies be up front.
Okay.
I think, yeah, I would go over there. Those books aren't going to look that good.
Oh, books are great. They look studious.
Yeah, we are very studious.
We love books.
Okay, one, two, three. Let's take another one just to be
okay.
Sure.
Cheese.
That was a pretty good one there.
Cheese.
Very nice.
So now we have been eternalized.
Right.
For eternity.